It's that time of the week on VLGA Connect when we check in with the CEO, Kathryn Arndt, for a look back at the happenings of the week, some of the topics we've covered on our show, and a bit of a look forward as well. Kathryn, hello and welcome again.
Thank you. Hi, Chris. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. How's the week been for you?
Look, it's been a big week. I must say I'm feeling a little discombobulated, but I just think it's that time of... Well, I think there's probably a few of us feeling the same way. It's such an unprecedented time.
And it's always good to have an excuse to use a big word like that.
I think so too. I love that word. It's fabulous.
There's, now I forgot, it's just got out of my head, but there is a word for someone who has a tendency to use long words, and I'll think of it in a moment. But that's by the by, that's of no import whatsoever. So this week, a few things happening that we've covered and will cover on VLGA Connect. The big one being the omnibus bill that's been passed by the Parliament, with just a small piece in there that now paves the way for councils to conduct their meetings online.
Yes, you're right, Chris. And this has been something that a number of councils have been advocating for. And what the legislation will now allow for, commencing from the 1st of May, is for councils to have virtual meetings, virtual formal meetings. And that will allow them, of course, to continue with the business of council as normal, but in a virtual sense. The VLGA has actually been working with the state government on developing the guidelines and the protocols that will sit behind those virtual council meetings. They're quite high level principles, including probably three, which essentially means that all virtual, ordinary and special meetings of councils must be publicly live streamed. So that will be a concept that those councils who currently don't live stream their meetings but wish to have virtual council meetings will need to, I guess, get their heads around. The other principles include that the ordinary business of council must continue, and that representation at council meetings by members of the public, so the public must be able to participate. So the detail of those guidelines will be coming out very shortly. On that topic, the VLGA will also be hosting some discussions, as we've done today already, with Stephen Cooper about what's involved with chairing a virtual meeting. And we've taken some examples there from the water boards that are currently are doing that. So if people haven't caught up on that episode of VLGA Connect, they should do that.
Yes, that's the latest governance update with Stephen Cooper. And looking ahead to next week, we're hoping to put together perhaps a more in-depth discussion, guidance for mayors and chairs. As some of them have said to me in our interviews, it's a very tiring space to manage online meetings. So there's certain things you can do to smooth the way.
Yes, and so as you said, we'll be running some training sessions and interactive panel discussions on that very topic. Councils should remember, of course, that there are already quite detailed and rigorous governance procedures and local laws in place at their council. So they will, of course, continue to support the council meeting, but just in another medium. Yes. Again, stay tuned for those VLGA sessions next week.
The other piece of news, Kathryn, that caught my eye was the release of the electoral structures that will apply for the upcoming elections. This was expected, of course, because with the new Act, there are some changes as to how those structures need to be determined. I think 10 councils will have a changed electoral structure. And that information's all there online for people to have a look at. The question I wanted to put to you, Kathryn, is I've heard some people equate that piece of information with elections in October not being delayed. But I think it's probably important to point that the two aren't necessarily linked, and the minister's still got that matter under consideration.
That's exactly right, Chris. Obviously, people would appreciate that in order to meet an October timeline, given that the Local Government Act 2020 only received royal assent earlier in the year, a number of things would need to take place to enable that to happen. The ward structure issue was one of those. So I don't think people should interpret that as a definitive at all about the council's progressing or the elections progressing or not. The minister has made it quite clear that he will call that in early May. So not long to wait yet. But of course, if the elections did continue and do continue, it's important that all of those steps that would precede them are still happening.
So, Kathryn, I think I'm allowed to say we've had agreement from the minister to appear on VLGA Connect in the next week or so. So, with any luck, he'll have his thinking to a point where he might be able to share with us what's going to happen come October.
Look, he may well or be very close to be able to do that. So, yes, that's great that we'll have that opportunity to talk to him next week.
Looking forward to that. Now, this week, we had a very in-depth discussion around the economic impacts of COVID-19 on local government that you were part of. I'm receiving some really good feedback on the opportunity to, I guess, explore a topic like that in more depth. It was an enjoyable experience, I think you would agree.
Yes, look, it was, and it certainly could have gone a lot longer than the 43 minutes that it did go for. And it was terrific to have John involved in that discussion. Although he's from South Australia, he's very familiar with the Victorian environment, and in fact is quite up to date with our new act here and also some of the matters that are currently before us. South Australia had introduced the ability for councils to meet virtually at the end of March, so he was able to share a few of their learnings from that for us, but also talk about ways in which councils need to start looking at potential loss of revenue over the next sort of 12 to 18 months and how perhaps there's some more innovative ways that they could manage that, such as, borrowing some money in the absence of rate collection or in the situation where they may defer rates. And he talked a little bit about what those costs might actually be. But of course, that's for every council to look at that in their own, in the context of their own circumstances. But it was a good discussion and worth watching.
Indeed. We also had Matthew Wilson from Pitcher Partners to provide a slightly broader context, I guess, because it's always good to be able to compare what's happening in the local government sector with perhaps what others are doing. John Comrie, you mentioned, is very familiar with the rate cap environment in Victoria, which is something we didn't really get an opportunity to talk about. But clearly, councils thinking around whether they would be applying for variations to rate caps are going to be directly impacted by their thinking around the longer term impacts of COVID-19, aren't they?
They are, and that actually came up at the CEO COVID-19 response forum that I participated in earlier in the week, that matter of rate cap and the state government, again, because it was a little too early, I guess, to look at when that next application process for a rate variation might occur, but it's certainly front of mind for the CEOs out there.
We do a scan of the news items that are coming through, and fair to say a lot this week has been around that virtual council meeting environment. But I also noticed that the City of Melbourne is taking their citizenship ceremonies online, and they're going to be conducted in a virtual environment as well. So the impact is really being felt across a whole range of local government processes.
That's right. And I do believe I saw the Lord Mayor on social media in the last day or so actually conducting one of those citizenship ceremonies, if I was correct. So it really is an opportunity for councils to look at the way they do things and adapt, and they're doing it so quickly and responsively.
And I think that's the takeaway, the agility and the flexibility, perhaps, that has never been really synonymous with any level of government, to be honest. But, you know, local government, no stranger there. The agility and the flexibility, I think, has perhaps surprised some people, but it's been really terrific to see. As I mentioned in one of our other interviews this week, there's been years of digital transformation done across the world in just 60 or 90 days.
Yeah, absolutely. And we talked a little bit about that on the panel with John and Matt the other day, and the opportunity, I think, when we come through this, to have a look at the way we engage and even within our democratic processes of that direct participation and representation, as well as through the elected representative model.
Yes. Kathryn, we've covered a bit of ground as usual. It's always good to catch up on what's happened and what might be coming. Another big week of VLGA Connect is on the way. Before I let you go, it wouldn't be VLGA Newsroom if we didn't give the YouTube copyright people something to do. So what are we going to challenge them with this week?
Well, look, I think the way I'm feeling today, I think I need something a little uplifting and also quite meaningful. So my choice for this week is Staying Alive.
From the Bee Gees. Excellent
that's
choice.
Right. Yes.
And that's really what we're all trying to do through COVID-19, isn't it?
Yeah.
In various ways. Yes.
Exactly.
Thank you, Kathryn. We'll go out with some, you can probably hear it underneath already, some staying Alive from the Gibb Brothers. And it's always good to speak. Look forward to catching up with you again next week.
See you then, Chris.
And so wraps up another week of VLGA Connect. To the strains of the Bee Gees, thanks for being with us. We look forward to having you with us for future episodes of VLGA Connect. And don't forget to let us know if you've got some story ideas that'd like to be part of the show. VLGA at vlga.org.au is the email address. Thanks for watching. See you soon.